So before starting this functional options, like we will cover a few things. Basically, why do we even need functional options, and then in what sort of things it actually makes sense. So let's assume that we have a custom server, or we want to build some library, and then we want to customize it for our users, right? Here, what we're going to build is, doesn't matter, but we're just going to, see how we're going to use the parameters and stuff to figure out how we're going to use it. So let's say, so this is the server which we will use generally to run the HTTP application, right? So this has plenty of configurations like address, some TLS configs, and read timeouts, and lot of other stuff. But let's say you are writing your own library, and then it's sort of a wrapper around the server. Here we just took server as a use case, but it could be anything. Let's say you have a server with instrumentation, which is New Relic or some tracing tools, and then you have a server which is wrapped around time-based logging, like okay, every request you need to log it. And then you also have something like StatsD integrated. So pretty much when you want to use the server, it's not just a simple application, right? You have to wrap it against multiple things. So in that case, what we generally do is we need to pass some parameters to build that particular sort of configuration, right? So let's just say we're gonna worry about timeout, or we're gonna worry about, let's say, custom handler, something like that. So these are the things clients or the callers have to give it to us, right? So like probably I can switch to other package which I have. That will be much more relevant, I guess. Okay, sorry. So probably I can use this as a medium to explain stuffs. So let me go into rate limiting. So for newcomers, right, anything in Golang you see middleware, it's sort of like we don't have separate repository, separate controllers, separate models, but rather we have something called handlers which deals with the HTTP request. So this is the HTTP handler which reads the request in JSON or other formats, and it writes the response to it. So this is the actual handler format. The moment you add to it, you have an API up and running. So given that, when you want to write middlewares or other functionality, like we were talking StatsD instrumentation or other logging metrics, you basically wrap it as multiple middlewares. So it's like you have middleware one, and then you wrap it with some logging middleware, and then that will be passed before. And then let's say you have rate limiting, right? Like rate limiting, you want to use any public API, you rate limit it to some certain limit so that you don't pass an attack. So you have rate limiting middleware, all those sort of things, it passes through each and every one as a chain. So that's how we use middlewares to wrap things. So here what we have is, in this library, I just wrote some set of middlewares which we can use. So let's say, filter is something where you want to filter some requests. Like, let's not worry about the internals of this middlewares, but some use cases, right? So you need a predicate, you have a request, whether to drop it or continue passing it. So this is filter middleware, right? Something like that. Predicate is just a function which returns a boolean on some premise. It either returns true or false. Like, it's just a condition, that's it. People call it predicate. And let's say we have rate limiting middleware. So rate limiting, like leave this configuration. Rate limiting, it takes some time, and then if it is rate limited, it sets like too many requests, 429. If not, it forwards the request further, something like that. So that is the point, right? Like, okay, this is a separate thing, but rather now all of this libraries, middlewares, multiple peoples could use it. Basically, this is a library. Anybody could use it. If I'm putting it in code, imagine rate limit or time-based timeouts, right? Every request you should serve within 2 seconds. If it is taking more time, you should just cut the response. All those things, it's not specific to the APIs, but rather it is applicable for all the APIs. So you will have tens and hundreds of handlers in your code. You wouldn't go and write it in each and every file. And also you can pull it out as a separate function and call it, but still middleware is a much better way because there is Negroni or there are other, even Mux. It has middleware stacking. So you just can inject, if it is public, I need rate limiting and authentication. If it is internal, I don't need those middlewares. So you could do stuff like that. It's actually keeping it separate from your code and the other middlewares, which is sort of enhancements, sort of decorators, you could say. So we saw filter, we saw rate limiting. This is a request logger, right? This is something like it takes a request, it computes the start time, it computes the end time, and then it just logs it. Okay. So anytime for newcomers, you see next is the next handler you're supposed to call, and then serve HTTP is just like serving the actual HTTP. So this is one middleware which is processing your request, and this is the next middleware in the chain of line that you're gonna call. So now we know that we have some middlewares, right? So this is the other timeout which I was talking about. So given a time, it should close the handler within that time. If it is taking more time, we should just stop it. So something like where is our timeout? With timeout. So this particular request, it has a timeout with the context. So we have multiple middlewares now. So now how will you build a particular service, right? Or your custom middleware, right? So what you could do is initially, so let's just start from base. So this will be the next handler which you're gonna call next, right? This is the basic thing you would require. And let's say we don't have anything else. How would you know what are the middlewares to attach? So basically now we have filter, logging middleware, and we have stats middleware, and we have timeout middlewares, right? So depending on the use case, we need to attach it, right? So how would you do that? Is basically first initial quick immediate thought is, okay, I'll pass parameters, arguments to the functions. So I'll say, hey, logging enabled is boolean, true, right? No, not necessary. That is why we are doing this new middleware where sometimes you just want a filter, right? Sometimes you just want logging.
Okay.
So client should be able to customize it. You are giving a library with 10 things. The way of stitching the middlewares, it should be depending on the callers. So that is why, that is the objective of this function, right? So now that is why we are saying, okay, initial attempt would be, okay, if logging is enabled, then basically I can say handler is equal to next, let's say, and then fill, let's say logging. So something like this, right? I can say you wrap logging with whatever configuration you have, and then you call the next handler, and then you sort of wrap it inside this. So let's just say there is a logging thing. Here I wrote more configurations, so because of which we can just take a simple thing and then go with it. So let's just take, I'll just take timeout, okay? So for timeout, we need a timeout duration, we need to pass that, and then this returns a middleware, okay? So let me just add it, timeout, t is a, thank you. Yes. That is not part of this, but we need to do it in your server, right? So imagine this is a library, and it just exposes you the list of middlewares. Oh, for that middlewares, right? Let me just close this. I'll go to timeout. We are implementing this, right? So we have a func which takes a handler and returns a handler, and that is where we are calling next.serve HTTP. So these are all just handlers. All of them are handlers. So the middleware contract, if we notice, it's actually anything which takes a HTTP handler, it returns a HTTP handler. I was using handler func, but there are other libraries which depends on mostly handlers. So because of which I shifted to handler. So for others, like handler is something like an interface. It's almost like anything, anybody who's implementing the interface could run as a server. But we also have something called a handler func, which also has a same similar contract, but it's not an interface. You could just use a simple function as a a handler to deal with requests and then write responses. So handler func and handler could go hand in hand, and depending on the your conventions, you would either use handler func always or handlers in other places. So yeah, so now we have a timeout. All we need is a timeout. We need to pass a timeout, and then that returns the middleware, right? So let's go back to the middlers. Okay, so if logging enabled, we do something with logging. If let's say we have a timeout, right, we need to have a, like, let's say somebody passes timeout, timeout not equal to zero, then what you're gonna say is h is equal to timeout, we're gonna pass timeout, and which so this again returns the middleware. Okay, yeah, something like this. So leave the handler's implementations, but rather what we are talking about here is you take parameters, and then depending on the each and every parameter, you stitch that middleware, right? So if timeout is non-zero, then you actually add the timeout middleware, you wrap it, right? So, but the moment we have more stuffs adding in here, it's going to be difficult. So now let's say I want stats enabled. Bull. It's time to duration. I don't know whether this would be like zero would work. What we can do is time dot duration of zero would actually work. The default value. I just wanted to check the default value. That's it. Yeah. So like probably now we are actually talking about the problems. So now what do you think could be the problems with this new middleware function which is returning you the handler? Yes.
Why don't you, instead of passing all these things in variable, why don't you just create that new middleware struct and use that?
You still have initialization struct.
Correct. So yes, I was basically going step by step. So now, the moment we have parameters, the moment you have two, three things, there are multiple problems. Now, how do we know if something new is coming up, you're breaking the other callers? You would have three arguments, but the moment you add the fourth one, you have to change in all the callers. And what sort of order makes sense? Like the moment you have timeouts and also time.duration multiple values, which one is which argument? Unless you have a good idea which tells the types of the arguments also, this is going to be difficult. So this is going to be cumbersome. Like there are more problems like, okay, what will be the default values? What are we going to do with it? How can we skip some values, right? So all these things we can't do here. So which is why, as he was saying, we could move to a struct, which is basically like, let's call it mwconfig, right? So we can write something like mwconfig and have all this logging enabled bool, timeout duration, and let's say stats address, okay, let's say some string. And then we can actually use this instead of using a parameter, right? So now this becomes cfg dot something, this becomes cfg dot timeout. So now whenever you have additional things, all you're going to do is change this particular thing, which is let's say custom logger, right? Or we're going to add anything, this contract wouldn't break. But they just need to, like, if it is in the same code base, everything will work fine. If it is a library, they just upgrade to the new version and then they pass in write configuration required. All with me. So this is sort of eliminating the, cumbersome of dealing with multiple arguments to the functions. But now this is not the end. Now the problem is here, what if somebody wants to, create a middleware chain, or in case of server, right, I don't care about what is the configuration. Most of the times I just want a default configuration. So I don't want to pass this value at all is one thing, right? So I don't care about these things. So what will people start doing is I'll do something like new middleware of mwconfig, some empty thing, right? So this is what people will start doing. So this is one problem. And the second thing is still optional values or default values, what are we going to do with that, right? So let's say we have some other thing, let's say DB timeout. Let's say we have a DB timeout, which is an integer. Now, which is default and which is some other value, right? Like if it is a library, what if you want DB timeout, or like in this case, DB timeout doesn't make sense. If somebody sets this to zero, you can't just go and say a context with timeout is zero, right? Because then it'll stop working. But rather, you need to know which is actual values and which is optional values. And based on the optional values, you need to fall back to a default behavior. So if DB timeout is zero, you set the default timeout to be some 500 milliseconds, something like that. So this abstract configuration helps in a way that you can document each and every fields what this is doing. This helps, and you don't need to change the contract. But still, two problems of I don't want to pass the configuration, custom configuration at all. And then how do we deal with some values which are optionals? That is still an issue there. So those are the major things, I guess. Let me just check whether I missed anything here. Yes, one more thing is correct. We didn't talk about this. So, the moment we have arguments, like I forgot to mention is, in server, you would want a TLS server in one case. In some case, you want a default server with timeout. So we were talking about like either you could pass 10 arguments and then pass dummy values to the other one, but rather what we will be doing is create new functions for each and every use case. One new function which just takes a TLS configuration, new TLS server. One new function which just takes timeout, new server with timeout. So then depending on the permutation, you would have to write functions to deal with the requirements. So scaling becomes really hard there. So which is a point that also, pain that we forgot to mention here. So yeah, so now coming back to this, I'll just close this. Yeah, so now how do we deal with the optionals, right? Like how do you think we can avoid passing this particular thing, default thing? Any quick thoughts? Builder? Correct. So let's say we pass new build config, which is going to return mwconfig.
Yeah.
But again, we would have to use something like we need to do builder, pass builder here.
So what I'm saying is, why don't you just implement the middleware itself? Why can't it be a struct? So instead of you passing the config, why can't the type, you just define type mwconfig, right? Why can't you just define type new middleware or something?
No, so here we have 10 middlewares. We want to customize which middlewares to pick. In case of server, right, you're not going to pass server, but rather you want to customize the configuration of server. Yeah. So the object, the objective is not middleware, like what middleware you're going to use. It's like you have 10 middlewares, which middlewares to use, and out of this few, you have to configure the middlewares, right? So if you use a timeout middleware, you need to give timeouts. If it is a statsd, you need to give a statsd address. If it is not there, you shouldn't just use the middleware, right? So it's customizing the configuration, something like that. So yeah, in server, you can build a struct. I get what you're saying. You can just build a struct and then pass in configuration. But that is plain server. The moment you want to add features to it, you will have a custom server, right? Let's say you're building on top of that, if you have multiple things, then you want to customize it. It's not the default values for the default server, a struct and the HTTP, but rather your own customization. The use case could be anything else, but the objective is you need to customize something based on some configurations. So that's the objective. So even here, right, like the weird thing would be is to pass like this struct, empty struct. Even if we have a builder, we would end up passing the builder and dot build, and then that would give us a configuration. The immediate thought would be what we could do is, okay, instead of taking a actual struct, I could take a pointer. So in this way, what we could do is, instead of calling with value, you can say nil, right? This could work in the college perspective. But again, it's sort of weird to pass nil to a library, right? And also here we need to handle nils. So if CFG not equal to nil, then use a default configuration, right? Something like this. So here we would have to do something like this. This is sort of also a different weird thing. To get around with that, what we can do is pass in a varargs. Varargs just like any other, any other language. I guess this is the syntax. So what we could do is you can basically say new config, and you can say next, and you can leave the option. That'll still work. So we can actually try something like and see whether it's actually building instead of me writing in the comments. So this will just build. So if I don't have it, it's gonna fail. It should. Sorry. Let me just build it and see what happens. So I have other things as well. We need to, let's just make it in a return way. I can't write this http.default server. Okay. Cool. So this works. And no, this is returning a handler, but it's missing something. So I just thought I can return a default thing. Sorry. Yeah. Not phone handler. Okay, it's a function. Now let's just say no, we can't pass nil, but HTTP. Like I'm just taking some value and then trying to pass the timeout middleware itself, or I need to pass some func, which is HTTP. This is a middleware, right? We can just use this for now, just to keep it in a build state. Okay, so now we have an issue where we have HTTP handler but want the other configuration as well. The moment we have varargs, it's optional. So now let's build it again, and then let's see what are we missing. Logging enabled. Okay, we didn't do everything properly, so let me just fix it. Okay.
CFG is an array.
Yeah, sorry.
Yes.
So let me just do this for now. Like now this is again a problem. We have to check the the number of arguments which you are passing, and
whether it's in the right order or not.
Correct. And even if you have multiple things, what happens to that is all a problem. So let's just use this handler like this. So now it's in a successful state. So the problem, as we saw, is the moment you have multiple configuration, you can choose to do multiple things. One is either you could go through each and every configuration, and how do you deal with conflicting configuration, right? And the first one you could mention timeout is 10 seconds, the other one you could mention timeout is 2 seconds. Or we can restrict saying, hey, you cannot pass multiple configurations, just pass one. And if the length of array is more than one, just panic or whatever. So still this piece of code is very weird. We can enhance it further, and that is where a functional option comes in. So basically we saw multiple ways to customize config by passing parameters, by passing a struct. The moment you pass a struct, you want to pass defaults and optionals, and because of which we ended up doing this sort of weird thing. So the functional option, how it comes here is, still we're going to use a configuration, but it is not directly exposed outside to the caller, but rather we use a function to modify the values. So what we will have something is, it's a function. It takes a MW configuration it returns MW con. No, it doesn't have to return anything actually. It just takes a, what do you call that, custom option. So let's just say custom option. That's it. So what this means is you have to define a custom option, and that function will have this config value inside it. So what it means is you can mutate the states from the caller itself, and then you can pass that options down the, to the library. So let me also quickly refer. So option and yes. Okay, sorry, yeah. So here everybody got it, right? Like now instead of using a configuration, getting a configuration directly from the clients or callers, like we are doing in new middleware. But rather what we're gonna get is a function, and that function is gonna mutate the configuration. And the configuration will not be exposed directly. What I mean by that is not the struct. The struct will be still exposed, but the values inside it doesn't have to be exposed. Like previously he was saying, if we pass in a configuration like CC, let's just call it strict CC, you have to expose all the fields, right? You have to expose all the fields, stats, enabled, bool. If it is a same package, fine, but if you are writing a library, all of this you have to expose, then only you could do CC dot, you can do CC of timeout, some time dot duration of 100, right? But the moment you make it a small case and then you don't expose it, how will the library change it, right? Like the caller change it. So you can't. So it's, we are sort of not exposing the struct in a way by protecting the fields, but we are still exposing the struct. So everyone got it? Like, okay. Because you just take functions, and the functions decides what to change in the configurations. And in fact, the config, I could keep it in any other way. Like the fields doesn't matter. Not really, but you taken a function, and then the function decides what to do with the struct. So it could be anything. So here, yeah. So to your question, right? We build a configuration like this. This is the CC and timeout. But the moment we have a custom configuration, we can't do timeout because it's not exposed to the other packages. So the only way to change the configuration is adhering to this function which we wrote newly. And like probably I could write one thing and then that would sort of explain it. Let me try. So it's in same package, but what we are writing is same package, but imagine we are writing in a separate package. So what we will end up writing is, it's a timeout change function, right? Timeout function. Let's just say, call it this way. And then this is a function which takes MW config, right? And then C, okay? And then this function, what it could do is, it could do C dot timeout is equal to 10 seconds. Right? So like I'm just trying to explain what this function is, then we'll go about like how we really use it. So this function takes in the configuration and you mutate the variable, and this is possible because it's only available within your package, right? So probably I'll also separate the separate the file so that it'll be much better. Some middlers to test something. Okay, so I'm just going to copy the code, whatever we had here, and put it here. And middlers for test. So I need to import middlers. The other package, I called it gomw. So let me just call gomw. Sorry. I need to, it's in different names, so I need to import this, and then the middlewares would work. Sorry. I'm missing something. Just give me a minute. Support test. Can't load package. Middlers found packages before. Okay. So I was writing changes here, so it would have changed this. Let me just try one more time. If not, that's fine. So I have similar thing here, middlers. Let me just see how I'm using it. Yeah, it's working fine. So let me just remove this. Build controller package, form packages. So I'm changing the same package and then it's sort of failing. I don't know how I could put this, so let me go here. Let me see whether I can add the same code here. It's a test file which I already had. So let's say go build expected package foo test. I'll just delete the library. So this is building, and okay. So now we have our test flow. So let's see now how this goes. So now this is working. Go test type and run test flow. Okay. So now we are in the buildable state. So just to set the page again, we are in a different package. So it is almost like you are a client library and then you are using somebody else library. So this is not directly accessible. This is not like the same package. We are not writing code in the same package. So what we are doing is we are doing go middleware.cc stuff. So here you are able to change the timeout, right? Because it is accessible, correct? But the moment I want, let's say, we'll just print it because if not it'll fail. I'm gonna say mw config, right? I cannot do timeout, right? Time dot duration 100. Sorry, yeah. Okay. So again, this is MWC, let's just call it something, MWC. Okay, so for the people who's new to Go, right, like the variable names inside the struct, if it is capital, it's exposed. If it is not exposed, so what it means is you cannot access mwc.timeout in different packages. It's just like almost like a private fields in Java. So now, given this configuration, how do you think you can change this particular timeout fields? So that is what I meant by protecting the values, right? So the fields could be anything, but the only the way it could be changed is via functions. So now people could guess, like, how can you change this configuration, variables inside the struct?
As far as I know, I would actually, based on what I have written, I would actually write functions to set and get
correct, but again, it's sort of like you're writing getters and setters. Yes, that is doable. But it's sort of going in an opposite way where like you will have plenty of functions for all the fields. And the moment you wrap a field with a getter and setter, it's almost like exposed. And you can't change those things as well. Like whenever you want to change the field names, whenever you want to change the contract, it again becomes difficult, right? So yes, you could do that, but that becomes
then
weird.
Again, but then again, the getters and setters you can actually keep the same. You can change the field names.
No, but getters and setters, it's not idiomatic in Golang perspective, right? In Java way, we have seen it. But ideally, if you think of it, I've seen a lot of cases where you have a class, four fields are private, but they have getters and setters for all the four fields. Like, I don't know why would it be needed.
I have seen reasons to actually do that, but still, fine. That's the idea.
Yeah,
that's
sorry?
No, I just wanted to say, the highlight, the main objective that we're trying to achieve, right, is avoiding or rather resolving any sort of conflict that can happen. So it's not even the fact that, you know, the field names are different or getters and setters. It's just that, you know, in this case, when you expose a function, the idea is you create some sort of a singleton object reference state, which is then being mutated by means of a function.
Correct.
Which others can call and do that, so that there's just one copy of that configuration at any given time, rather than having multiple configuration objects and then
Sort of one config, it's sort of true, that is also true, but it's very easily extensible. Like, probably we can go on and then I'll show you all the functions, or it's sort of building configurations. The building could be done by the actual package, but you just need to use it properly with functions, that's all. And we are not tied to the fields or anything like that. Like that, as you said, it's true, like it's sort of very extensible, and the way we write code becomes much more clean. So this code will become much easier, like that we will show. So actually, guys, here you will have 10 fields, right? Like the moment we have this, we will have stats, the address, then do something. So here you understand the complexity, right? Here we will have 10 fields. Like probably we are trying to optimize this. Like we are trying to make it very simpler. This is what we are trying to do. So given this, let's go back here. So how we're gonna change this is we have to write a function, and that function will only be able to change the value, and you cannot write that function because it's in a different package, right? So let's go to middler foo. Let's say I want a timeout, right? Let's say middleware with timeout, and what this can take is it takes a middleware config C, and it doesn't do anything, and you can just say, now you can say C dot timeout is equal to let's say t time dot duration. Sorry, just a second. Timeout is equal to t. So this should actually return this function. So I still need to write values. Func and C mw config. And it changes this. Okay. C dot timeout. Yes. Yes.
So instead of writing a method like a function like mw with timeout, which returns a pointer to the mw config, why would you write a method to my mw config struct, which takes a pointer receiver since it's limited itself? So that's what you want, right?
I mean, yes, that's what I said. Like the function will remain same. I get what you're saying. So you can actually write this this function, attach it with MW config, so that you call the method. But it almost becomes like a getter and setter, right? Sorry, it almost becomes like a setters.
No, so what you're doing is, even though you're not technically a getter or setter, that's what you're doing anyway.
Correct. So, but the code here will differ. Like, I think here, what do you call that? Here the code still will remain same, right? How will you improvise this? You expose the setters. You expose the setters and the clients actually called it. But still the struct values, we need to use it. We need to deal with this separately. So the reason why we wrote the function inside the package is only the package can change it. I can't write the function in a different package because the values are like sort of private to this package, right? But it sort of becomes like a builder, but the code looks a little different, that's all. So now what I could do is, the moment I have MW with timeout, I could say go MW dot MW with timeout, and I can say time dot duration of 100, and this is the option.
So can I just interrupt?
Yes.
So people who have been writing Go would know, like, you have used context package, context has the same thing, the context with timeout, context with cancel. Same thing with GRPC server. If you have GRPC server.
But I think
what you're
trying to say is
that
the timeout is just an example.
No, it's an example. You have multiple configurations for your object that you're trying to create. For example, GRPC server, you say with GLS configuration, with middleware, with. So it's like you're configuring your structure in one shot. And it is easier for the package maintainer to master it, right?
Maintainer can provide these type of functions.
Yeah, it's easier for them also. They just iterate through it and they configure it as well.
Right. Yeah. So. Then we haven't changed this middler foo yet. So instead of taking configuration, now we can take options, and this options are gonna be this option C of custom option, let's say, right? So this becomes a C option. Yeah. So we take a varargs of C option. Let's just stick to this. We'll just hold this for now. Okay, so the contract of the function changed. What we are gonna, we exposed a function which is sort of COP. I can actually change this to a C option, right? This function is actually returning a C option which could mutate the configuration. So now how will this change, right? So now I can just say new middleware, and I can just say TOPT. Let's say just let's just print it just for the sake of usage. Undefined option C option. Let me just see where it is. Mullers foo 25. Yes. Thank you. Okay. But does have timeout. Okay. So the change is middlers test 66. We didn't change the test. So these things, we need to get rid of it. So let me just get rid of this. And yes. New middleware. I changed the name because the reason why I'm giving different names is I already have defined stuffs. So that is why I'm doing this. New middleware. And undefined new middleware, let's go mw dot new middleware, and this should work. Cannot just do a ps type of argument with this. Okay, so yeah, we're just missing pointer. Let me just fix it. Sorry, okay, so sorry,
go back to the caller.
Okay. No, right? It's just an option. Oh, yeah, we didn't change it here. Okay, this just can be options.
Yeah.
Sorry. Undefined MWC, just usual. Okay. So now this is passing. The caller, now what we could do is I can just say. Sorry, just a second. Go on w I'm just adding a dummy value, but assume that we are doing this, right? So I can just pass in multiple configurations which I expose here. So let's say middleware with stats. Let's just quickly write that as well. So let's say sum 127.01, whatever it is. And let's just add this here. So now we just defined another function. So the library exposes something like MW with stats, and then all you have to do is call this MW with mid stats. But this sort of, what do you call that? Earlier we would have been building this struct, but here what we're gonna do is, like, in this case is we are just using a mutating single thing, but the function could decide what to do with the actual struct and then what sort of configurations to change, right? So now based on this address, this guy actually can check if st not equal to empty, then do this, else I can define default address, something like c.start address is equal to some localhost default. So now the functionality is sort of grouped into only this, and the caller changed to this way, and I can do any number of calls and the call remains same. Now we can look at how this is going to change, right? So if everybody is in same page, like, any questions there, we can ask here, because now this is again going to be the just a simple call, but it's optimizing this code. So everybody understood C option, right? It takes a function, it's a function which takes a configuration exposed by the library, and the function, you can't define it, but the library defines it and exposes. All we have to do is call appropriate libraries, and it's all variable arguments. And now we dealt with optionals, right? Imagine we had 10 fields. We don't need to call each and every function. We just call whatever which is required. So we have optionals, and we don't need to pass anything if we don't want anything also. So this is also buildable state. So we saw these are some problems which we had earlier. That's fixed. And also we were thinking, what happens to the default value, right? The default value is sort of handled in this place instead of me handling it here, which is config 0 dot stats tree address is empty, which is actually, it's a constructor, but this is doing all the job of all the configuration, right? So if we all in the same page with that, now this becomes like this. So I can say for each options, all I'm going to do is I need a configuration. Let's say this is our custom configuration. Okay. So my custom configuration, correct? Let's say this is a builder, or you can populate with default values. And then all I have to do is call this function with CC. So let's call it OPD. Okay. So now if you see it, now OPD is a function. So now the code just becomes this. I'm missing something. Let me quickly fix it. 443 cannot call non function OPT, it's integer. Okay, I just missed this. Cannot use CC as type MW config pointer. We can test it, we can just quickly test it, right? So let's just keep this, okay, and then what we can do is. Sorry?
You can print something in those configurations.
Yes. So let's just print this configurations, right? Form.println CC. Sure. So we can also do that. Yes. Form.println setting stats t. Setting timeout, that's it. Okay, so now if you print it, so we are actually setting stats t and setting timeout, and the config is actually set. So in this case, it's we are setting with stats, MW with stats, st not equal to empty, then we are setting it, return. Okay. Cool. So now if you notice, the code is just this, that's all. The middleware, which is the purpose of building, it just uses multiple options. And since it's a function, you just call this function with a custom configuration and you mutated it basically. And then anytime you want something, you can add a separate function and then do multiple things. So in this case, we just saw one variable mutation, but I can say func secure middleware, let's say authentication, right? So I can just call this, and then inside this, I can deal with multiple fields. Like I can set a passkey, I can set a username, password, lot of stuffs. So it's sort of like all of the functionality is separate, and we address the optionals, we address the default values, and finally the code is also simple. And whatever you do, right, whatever new functionalities you add, this code is never going to change. This code never will change. But in other cases, we saw, right, all the options, we would have to deal with it. So I don't know, like this was a huge difference with respect to code and then how we maintain it. Like we touched upon multiple things since it's new to everyone. If you have any questions, shoot me. If not, like you should go explore the functional options by yourself and then see it. So it's sort of nice in a way that like it's extensible and the code looks much more cleaner, and this is sort of idiomatic than having getters and setters also. So this is what with respect to functional options I had. Wow, it took 1 hour. Okay. Do you have any questions here? Like now I can actually go into the other place where I had, what do you call that? So this is sort of like, I'm also doing the same thing, but this is, I'm just showing it because, what do you call that? In this use case, we have to set it if it is not null. So if this configuration is available, then you set it. So we apply all the options, but still if the handler is enabled, then we set it. So in this case, it sort of becomes like this. So this code cannot go away, but in case of server or something, it'll be little different. I don't know, I can show you one more place also. And it's just a library we exposed. Yes. So.
How is
this function? Yes. Yes. Okay. Like I think we added. Yes.
Can you just go back to that previous thing?
Yes.
Now over here you are actually running the filter timeout and wait limit in the middleware.
Yeah.
Okay. What if you had run this thing right when you were doing it in the earlier functions? I mean the functions that you pass back to the user's application.
Correct.
And then see when it comes back over here as see the functions. It gets run from here, but it's actually declared inside the functions.
Yes. So I think what you're saying is very true. So in this case, but I need to have I need to have the handler attached with the struct, and I have to mutate the handler inside those options, right? That's what you're trying to say. So if I don't need to do this, what this basically means is I have to do it here, right? Before, after, hook, filter, let's say, let me just go here. So you're basically saying I need to do the chain here? But if you are doing the chain here, we need a common singleton struct or something which we can change it, right? So something like handler is equal to.
Still pass the handler to this function, right? I don't know whether that's a bad idea or not. Still.
We could do that, but what would end up happening is let me show the code which it using. So right now. What we would need is you just need to pass a single handler, and everything else is pretty much options, right?
Yeah.
But why would I do this? Like I wouldn't want to do this.
Just go back to the function where you declare the predicate or
one. Yeah.
Okay. Now the predicate it's taking a function. Fine, that's fine. In the second one, return function C config here, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Next to C config, if you pass a handler as well.
Correct. So which basically means I can have a handler inside this handler. That's what you were trying to say, right? HTTP handler. Then I can basically say inside this C dot handler. But anyways, like I don't know whether it's the same point, but we need a reference to that handler, which is a sort of a singleton, not singleton associated with this particular configuration. If that is there, we could move these things to the actual options itself. Like, it was a name code, I just wrote it. But you can just notice this, that's it. Okay. So cool. I think that's all I had with functional options. I don't know whether we have time to discuss logs as well. If you have any questions, probably we can discuss on this so that everybody gets clarified. We can discuss the logs in next meetup itself. So any other questions with respect to this? Options, functional options. So all this talk or top content, right? Dave Cheney actually have given a talk, and you can actually go to the text version of his talk as well. He covered pretty much everything, and then I took a gist of it for the functional options. I think I have it here. So, there is a talk as well as his, text version of the talk, and he talks pretty much everything with respect to the servers. I took the points from this content. You can go through it. Like, I'll just share this in the meetup or in this channel as well. That's all. Like, basically we covered, like, it's variadic and we are dealing with default cases within the function itself, and it's much more configurable, flexible, and we are not dealing with nil or empty structs, which we had to do in the earlier cases. So it sort of makes the library writer's code much readable, nice, and also the clients just uses the functions in while calling it. Internally in our company, like, whenever we wrote libraries which is used at other companies, we use functional options to customize the library. It was useful in our cases. So yeah, if there's no other questions, we can close this.